Hello, I'm Seafood Source editor Sean Murphy, and welcome to another edition of Seafood Source TV, the bi-weekly video blog where we bring you news, information, and insights from the world of the seafood industry. Well, seafood producers, processors, and dealers all know that their industry is often influenced, for good or bad, by public opinions informed by media reports. In particular, parents and parents-to-be are traditionally bombarded with all sorts of information about health and diet for their children. One of those mantras concerns fish and its potential mercury content. Like many metals, mercury can be toxic in heavy doses, particularly in developing children. Well-documented cases have shown that high mercury dosage in children has been known to cause a number of serious and permanent developmental disorders, including cerebral palsy. These reports about mercury's ill effects have been enough to force nutritionists, health food activists, and sometimes even doctors to caution parents against feeding certain fish to their children. But is that advice sound? And even if it is it possible that too many parents have decided to cut fish out of the family's diet altogether? And could that cause its own form of health problems? Well, here to talk with us today about this via Skype is Nick Ralston, a scientist with the Energy and Environmental Research Center at the University of North Dakota. His group has been trying to debate what he says are myths about the mercury content in fish for some time now. And his group recently helped produce a documentary on the subject through PBS called Fish, Mercury, and Nutrition, The Net Effects. Nick, good to have you with us today.
Oh, I'm very happy to be here.
Well, I don't need to tell you how much anti-mercury advice has been floating around out there. Put this in perspective for us. Where did it all begin?
Okay, well, mercury's always been known to be a problem if there's too much exposure to it, but recent concerns actually began back in the 1950s when people in Japan were eating mercury-contaminated fish. There was a small bay there called Minamata Bay that had a factory that had been releasing mercury into it for many decades, and so it was many tons of mercury that were released into this small bay. So the fish that lived in that bay became mercury poisoned. The people that were living nearby, though, were unaware that the mercury was going into the bay, and they consumed the fish as they always had done. But suddenly there were these terrible adverse effects showing up. It was not a case of just mercury exposure. It was actually a catastrophe where there was poisonous amounts of mercury in the fish. What they found was the people that were exposed to these huge amounts of mercury had very severe adverse effects. And in cases where mothers had been eating these mercury contaminated fish, they found even if the mother wasn't showing severe effects, their children were. Based on that, there became concern, since mercury is normally present always at much lower amounts in ocean fish, that, well, maybe the low amounts of mercury from ocean fish consumption might cause harm. So a number of studies were initiated that examined this issue. Some of them were done in the places where there were notably high mercury exposures. These were communities that were eating seafood on a very regular basis as a major part of their diet. Two of the major studies were in the Faroe Islands and in the Seychelles. The study in the Faroe Islands involved high mercury exposures from eating pilot whale meat. About 85% of their mercury exposure came from pilot whale meat and 15% from eating the codfish they consumed. That study found there were harmful effects. But other studies, such as the one done in the Seychelles, found that mothers that ate more ocean fish had children that had improved IQs, not any diminishment, even though their mercury exposures were on average higher than in the Faroes.
Why was this not
well understood. Studies that were going on at that time were actually, they were very confused about why this would possibly be. However, from a selenium perspective, my background is in selenium nutrition. It turns out that all of the mercury issue is about selenium physiology. Anybody that tells you they know about mercury toxicity but can't tell you what happens when mercury enters the body and how it impacts selenium physiology, that's like talking to a 16-year-old about balancing their checkbook, and they say they understand it completely but can't understand why they are out of money when they still have blanks in their checkbook. I mean, it's ludicrous. You cannot understand the mercury issue if you don't understand selenium physiology.
Okay, well, without going into exhaustive detail on it, just what is the relationship between selenium and mercury in fish and in the human body? Why is that so important?
Well, selenium is what protects our brains against oxidative damage. So the functions of selenium in the brain and in our endocrine organs throughout the body, these require selenium. If you don't have the selenium present, those enzymes that protect us against oxidative damage are unable to perform their function. Now, normally, these enzymes cannot be impaired in any way because our diets have sufficient selenium. Nothing that we have encountered in life will ever impair our selenium except mercury. High mercury binds the selenium, makes it unavailable to perform its functions, and that causes toxicity, not because mercury itself is causing harm, but because mercury has bound the selenium and keeps it from protecting us against oxidative damage. If you don't have those enzymes, you're going to have oxidative damage in tissues that you definitely don't want to have get damaged.
But now the new documentary that came out on this subject talks about this and mentions that a lot of ocean fish out there, even ocean fish that may be high in mercury content, is also high in selenium content. So does that mean by consuming regular ocean fish, you're taking in selenium along with the mercury?
Yes, you're actually, the more ocean fish you eat, the better protected you are against mercury. Ocean fish contain huge amounts of selenium relative to mercury. I mean, it really almost doesn't matter how much mercury there is there. I say almost, you don't want to have high mercury exposures, obviously. But what matters most is the selenium to mercury ratio. If you get 20 seleniums for every mercury you're exposed to, and mercury's going to steal one selenium, you're still 19 seleniums to the good. The only studies that have ever shown harm have involved exposures to foods that contain far more mercury than selenium. And the only seafoods that we've encountered that contain more mercury than selenium are pilot whales, which contain about 5 mercuries for every selenium. So eating that's a really bad idea during pregnancy. Some shark meats can be almost as bad as that, but not all shark. Some other varieties of seafood, swordfish at the larger varieties of swordfish, you can have a bit more mercury than selenium, but it's nowhere near as bad as shark, and certainly not anywhere at all like pilot whale.
And we're still talking about some pretty exotic species too. I mean, when you get down to the regular stuff, you know, the canned tuna, the salmon, the cod, the haddock, these ocean fish aren't dangerous at all.
Absolutely. In fact, all of those contain many times more selenium than mercury. So eating those will protect against mercury toxicity. They won't contribute to causing it. In fact, the study in the Faroes that we base all of our warnings about whether or not eating seafood is safe on a study where 85% of the mercury came from pilot whale meat. That study found that the more ocean fish the mothers ate, the better protected they were against mercury toxicity. So ocean fish are not showing up as causing mercury toxicity, but they are showing up as preventing it and improving IQ points in children by several very significant IQ points. The harms that were seen in the Faroes were not big. They were parts of an IQ point, and you can only recognize those because it was a large enough study to see such a small impact. The mercury impacts in the Faroes were minor. The huge benefits of ocean fish consumption are up to three to five IQ points of benefit. So it's really sad that we're currently have many moms avoiding eating ocean fish because they're fearful of adverse effects that even if they were eating pilot whale meat would only be part of an IQ point. But because they're avoiding ocean fish, they're potentially losing their children 3 to 5 IQ points of benefit.
Now, this is a particular interest, I think, to the seafood industry as well, because you know, for years now, the advice has been kind of a little bit simpler and perhaps more incorrect to say, you know, just try to lay off of ocean fish altogether. You know, there's been talk about, you know, don't feed your children too much tuna fish or anything like that. And, you know, this is obviously having an effect on, to some degree, on the tuna industry and a number of the other seafood industries out there. Do you think, Nick, that it's time now to look to some sort of national campaign or some sort of educational effort to try to get the word out about studies like yours?
Absolutely. We've got children whose mothers are avoiding ocean fish, which we know would benefit their health, improve their IQs, and these mothers are, for the benefit of their children, they're assuming wrongly, based on what the media has been telling them, that they can't eat too much ocean fish. In reality, they should understand that the other way. Rather than thinking you can't eat too much ocean fish because it would be bad, we should have them thinking you can't eat too much ocean fish because the more you eat, the better it is for you and your child.
Okay. Interesting stuff. Very interesting studies, a fascinating documentary, and hopefully the seafood industry and hopefully the general public picks up on that, and maybe we'll see a trend shift the other way. Nick, thanks very much for your time and for your insights on this. Very interesting.
Well, very happy to be here, and I hope that we can actually make a change soon.
That's Nick Ralston. He's a scientist with the Energy and Environmental Research Center at the University of North Dakota, talking to us today about the mercury content in ocean fish and just how dangerous or not dangerous it seems to be for you. So keep watching SeafoodSource.com for more stories about mercury, more stories about tuna, and more stories about the seafood industry in general. And be sure to check back here in 2 weeks for another edition of Seafood Source TV, where we'll bring you more news, information, and insights from the world of the seafood industry. For now, I'm Seafood Source Editor Sean Murphy saying thanks for watching, and we'll see you online.